Welcome, folks. We're going to give it another minute or so before we get started. Okay. So we are recording today, I believe that the recording will be made available on our website. So just want everybody to be aware of that. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Okay. With my screen sharing, I'm not really able to see anybody anymore, but I can keep an eye on the chat. So feel free to throw a question in there if there's anything that you want answered right away. Otherwise, we'll leave some time for questions at the end of our webinar. So hello, everyone, and thank you for coming today. I would like to start with a land acknowledgement. We acknowledge that the lands on which Basty University stands and on which we hold our event today are the traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of Indigenous peoples, particularly the Coast Salish people in Kenmore and Seattle, Washington, whose spiritual connections to these lands forms the foundations of their ways of being. We recognize and esteem the values, vast knowledge, and collective wisdom of these nations from the past and present. We honor their resiliency as we recognize the history of oppression, racism, and extreme hardship that has and continues to affect their communities. We at Basty University endeavor to be stewards of the lands on which our institution stands, embrace Indigenous ways of knowing through our programs and initiatives, and strive toward policies and practices that bring about justice and reconciliation. We understand that land acknowledgement is only a first step in honoring the contributions of Indigenous peoples today. And we ask that you take some time to learn more about the land where you live, work, and play, and that you reflect on your engagement as we manifest these intentions as one Basty community. So my name is Wendy Gordon. I've been a midwife for almost 20 years, and I'm a proud graduate of Seattle Midwifery School. In 2019, I was among the first group of midwives in the United States to earn a doctorate in midwifery from Thomas Jefferson University. That's what the DM stands for. I also hold a master's in public health from Oregon Health and Science University. I am an associate professor and the chair of the Department of Midwifery here at Basty University. I'm a certified professional midwife, or CPM, and I am licensed in Washington State, where I have practiced in a freestanding birth center in Seattle. The LM after my name stands for licensed midwife. Before I became a midwife, I was an engineer in an oil refinery and then a corporate recruiter. Unlike some of you who may have always known that you wanted to be a midwife, for me, midwifery is my third career. So I want to talk a little bit about the maternity care system in the U.S. It is in crisis. One in three childbearing people today give birth by cesarean. This rate is twice the rate that the World Health Organization recommends as the upper threshold. Our cesarean rate hasn't changed for over 15 years, despite multiple efforts by obstetric organizations to bring it down. Families of color experience worse outcomes on all measures, especially Black and Native American families. Rates of preterm birth, infant mortality, maternal mortality, all of these are multiple times higher for Black and Native families in the U.S. In New York City, Black maternal mortality is 12 times higher than for white birth givers. The system is failing Black families, Indigenous families, and people of color. Birth can and should be a life-changing event, but mistreatment and disrespect during childbirth is widespread. These are all symptoms of a maternal child health system that has not changed appropriately to meet the needs of the population, a system that overuses technology to compensate for its inability to provide human-to-human care. Overuse of technology can actually create worse outcomes in much the same way that underuse of technology can. But there is a better way. Bastyr's Department of Midwifery has clinical and leadership programs that focus on wellness during the childbearing year within the midwifery model of care. The system has to change, and not in a band-aid sort of way. The midwifery model of care has been shown to improve outcomes in many other high-resource countries. We offer a 3-year Master of Science in Midwifery and a 1-year Master of Arts in Maternal Child Health Systems. Both of our programs focus on building leadership within a midwifery framework and a social justice framework, because these inequities cannot stand. Centering the health and well-being of Black, Indigenous, and people of color in the healthcare system must be a priority. And we know from decades of research and practice that when these communities are centered, health outcomes improve for everyone. Midwifery care makes a difference. Our graduates are equipped with the skills to reduce cesarean rates, improve not only individual health, but community health, and restore optimal maternal and infant outcomes on the family's terms. The midwifery model of care rests on the fact that the individual is the best decision maker for themselves and their family. The patriarchal, I know what's best for you model of U.S. healthcare has not worked. In our model of care, individuals are given lots of information about various tests and procedures during pregnancy, given time and space to ask questions and receive full answers, and then are supported to make the decisions that are right for them. We recognize that not everyone should or wants to give birth at home or in a freestanding birth center. So this model must be incorporated within hospital systems of care as well. But individualized care makes a difference. Understanding social determinants of health makes a difference. And we believe that you can make a difference. At Bastyr University, we seek to transform the health and well-being of the human community. In programs in the Department of Midwifery, we do this through the art and science of midwifery, humility, and leadership. We expect all of our graduates to be leaders, and we have a long legacy of leadership in our professions. The healthcare system as it currently stands is not transforming health and well-being in a positive and generative way. And this begins with birth. There is little more transformative than giving birth. And we know how this could be for everyone. All families deserve the kind of care that results in a transformative birth experience. The midwife's model of care rests on several principles that can be applied in any birth setting. We believe that pregnancy and birth are normal life processes. We minimize the use of technological interventions, recognizing that sometimes they are truly needed. We believe that midwives are experts in the care of people with low-risk, healthy pregnancies. We monitor the well-being of the whole person, physical, psychological, and social. We believe in continuity of care. You should know the provider who will be with you during labor and birth. And we know that birth can occur safely in the home and freestanding birth center settings for people with low-risk pregnancies. We are trained to recognize complications and transfer to settings with more interventions when it's needed. So what does all this mean for you? Midwifery is a soul calling for many people. If you can't imagine not doing this work, you are in the right place. If you're committed to changing the system so that it works better for all childbearing families, we share your commitment. If you're ready to be a leader in midwifery and maternal child health systems, we can help you reach your goals. It's going to take all of us, so we got to get to work. So let's start with a quick overview of the midwifery program. It is a 3-year Master of Science program. We have an undergraduate entry option, which means that if you don't have a bachelor's degree, that's okay. You can still enter our program as long as you have at least 90 credits of undergraduate coursework. And we do have a set of prerequisites that must be included in that undergraduate work. We use a blended learning model, which means some of our work is done online and some of it is done face-to-face in the classroom. And I'll talk a little bit more about that with the next slide. We have clinical rotations that begin in the spring quarter of year one. So it's layered on top of the coursework that our students are doing. And so this slide might give you a little bit more information about how this blended model works. So in the first year, this part of it here, students are on campus for 4 to 7 days out of every month. And those 4 to 7 days are all together in 1 week. And then they do their assignments and have discussions online for the remainder of the month. In year two, the length of the on-site weeks goes down to 3 or 4 days a month. And in year three, it's only 1 or 2 days per month that the students are on campus. The clinical training, otherwise known as practicum, involves working directly with a midwife or group of midwives who are trained preceptors. So students essentially shadow their preceptors during their office visits, doing prenatal, postpartum care, and at births. And over time, students take on more and more of the clinical involvement with the clients themselves. So you'll see here that this clinical practicum goes throughout the spring quarter of the first year, all the way through the second year and the third year, while students are also doing coursework. So it's a full 2 years of practicum. Students usually spend about 1 year at one clinical site, and then they go to a second site for another year. So when considering whether midwifery is the right career for you, and specifically the type of midwifery that we train midwives for, there are several things to think about. One is the on-call lifestyle of a midwife. Rather than working an 8-hour shift or a 12-hour shift, midwives who attend births in people's homes or in freestanding birth centers are typically on call. And this means that whenever the client goes into labor, day or night, we drop whatever we're doing and we go. And many times it is the middle of the night when babies decide to come. Once we're with the client and they are in labor, we stay for the duration, however long that might be. This lifestyle isn't for everybody. If your body and brain can still function well on little sleep or interrupted sleep, then this could work for you. Another consideration is relocation for practicum. This is one of the biggest challenges for all midwifery programs, the availability of experienced preceptors. In this program, most of our preceptors are in Washington State, but we also have sites in Idaho, Oregon, California, and Arizona. We are always looking for new preceptors to add to our team. Many of our students must relocate for a placement in one of our approved clinical sites. So if you're up for an adventure, relocating for a year or two might be part of the experience in this program. Online learning. By now, most people have had the experience of learning online through the pandemic, for better or for worse. We have been incorporating online aspects of learning for over 20 years. And this gives our students the flexibility they need while they're in clinical practicum, because babies don't care if you have a class, and they're going to come when they're darn good and ready. If you have great time management skills, and the ability to prioritize 40 to 50 hours per week of online learning, this may be the program for you. And then licensure availability is also something to consider. Certified professional midwives like me are able to get a license to practice in about 37 states right now. There are still some states that don't offer licensure for CPMs, only for nurse midwives. So it's important for you to know what the licensure rules are in the state you're planning to practice in when you're deciding on a path to becoming a midwife. Our students have access to lots of university resources, such as tutoring, a counseling center, financial aid, and many student clubs. We have a vibrant campus located at the tip of Lake Washington within a state forest. It is amazing. There's also a student village where some of our midwifery students live while they're in the program. All of our courses are taught by practicing clinicians, and we've got a 40-year history, 40-plus years, originating with Seattle Midwifery School. And in 2009, Seattle Midwifery School merged in with Basty and is now the Master of Science in Midwifery program that we have today. We are MEEC accredited, which stands for Midwifery Education Accreditation Council. And the university is also regionally accredited, which means that your master's degree means something to other universities. So if you wanted to take your master's degree and continue your education, say with a doctorate of midwifery, other universities recognize this degree as valid. Our courses are taught by leaders in the profession. Over 70% of our faculty are also officers of national and state midwifery associations, perinatal health boards, and quality improvement collaboratives. It's pretty impressive, our faculty. Nearly 40% of the faculty in this master's level program have doctorates. And we take a social justice approach to everything we do. It is woven throughout our entire program with a foundation in a class that we call Power and Privilege in midwifery care. This sets the foundation for all of the courses that are part of our program. And our students have an option for either doing a thesis or capstone track or a specialty in botanical medicine. Both of these tracks are an equivalent number of credits that go through the second and third years of the program. A lot of our students are quite excited about the botanical medicine track because it allows them to take advantage of a lot of the herbal sciences lab and gardens that we have at Basty University. So it's a pretty exciting addition to our program. There are multiple careers that students will take after they graduate from our program. Many of them become home birth midwives or birth center owners. Most of our students join a team of midwives. They also, as we expect them to do, they advocate for midwifery legislation and policy at the state and national levels. And some choose to further their education at some point after they finish the program. So there are lots of opportunities for what midwives can do. And if this path is calling to you, your next step is to apply online at bastier.edu. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing and invite any questions that people might have at this time. You can either pop them into the chat or you can unmute and ask your question. We also have our lovely admissions advisor, Carrie Scully, here today.
Nice to meet you all. And I'd love to have a conversation with you and go over some of your previous education and talk to you further about how to apply with Basty.
I have a question. For like going other places for the program, you know, coming back to like for a week, once a month, how does that work? Is it paid for, or do we have to pay? Like, we get put out of state. How does that work?
Right. So we do have some students who do commute from other states, usually for the first 2 quarters until they begin practicum. And then students will often relocate if there isn't a preceptor in their area. So students who are commuting are either driving in or sometimes flying in, depending on how far away they are. We do have a pretty incredible scholarship opportunity for students who qualify, and that can help to pay for those transportation and relocation costs. But the cost of especially flying across the country, which some of our students have done, that can add up after several months of that. So it is something that students typically pay for, but we do have scholarships that can help to defray that cost. Camille, I think I saw you unmute at some point. Welcome you to ask your question.
Yeah, hi. I had kind of a follow-up on that last answer. When we spend 1 to 2 days at the school in the last years, how does that look with the preceptorship? Is everything shifted to online, or do we still have to commute back to the college?
Yes, students are still coming to campus for those 1 to 2 days in year three. And the reason we do that is because during those days, we're often practicing skills, like doing some of the hands-on type of work of learning how to be a midwife that we haven't quite figured out how to do online yet.
Right.
So there are certain skills like learning how to draw blood, learning how to start an IV, suturing, you know, learning how to make stitches, practicing birth emergency skills. So there are a lot of hands-on skills that we have to do it in person.
Okay, I understand. Do you find that more students will find a practicum that is closer by for that reason?
Well, I mean, we do have, I'm thinking about our third year students right now. Most of them are probably in Washington State. I think we've got one third year student in Portland, Oregon right now. We've got some second years who are in LA, Los Angeles. So there are students who are driving or flying in, mm-hmm. You know, for 1 or 2 days.
Yeah, that's not too, that's kind of a fun commute, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
At least to me, that sounds exciting.
I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. I see a question in the chat from Jess. Do we have choice in location of the practicum each year? And do we rotate between locations each semester or each year? Great questions. So we do have a process of matching students to preceptor sites. And what that typically looks like each year is that we build a map that shows where all of our sites are. And then when you click into the map, more information expands where you can read about that particular site. And it includes things like, are they doing home or birth center births or both? How many midwives do they have in the practice? How many births per month are they doing? That gives you a sense of their client load. And then other attributes about the practice. So students get to learn about the practices and decide where they would like to apply. And we encourage students to choose 3 to 5 different sites where they would be interested in applying. We help our students to develop resumes and cover letters to introduce themselves to the preceptors. And we send those resumes and cover letters out. The preceptors then look at the ones that they've received and decide who they would like to interview. Sometimes preceptors are only looking for brand new students who have not yet had any practicum. And some preceptors are looking just for senior level students who are almost ready to graduate. So depending on what the preceptors are looking for, they then make their selection of who they would like to interview. And then there is an interview. And sometimes that might have to happen over Zoom. A lot of times we hope it happens in person so that preceptors get to and students get to know each other and get a feel for, do we think this is going to be a great fit? After that interview occurs, the students then rank their top 3 choices. And with those rankings, then we start to make the matches. And ideally, the match looks like the student's number one choice matches with the preceptor's number one choice. We don't always have one-to-one matches, but those are the easy ones where everybody's, you know, matching one for one. But sometimes we have to go down to the student's second or third choice. Typically, then students are in a site for a full year, and then they go to another site for their second year. It is possible to do shorter rotations than that. However, by the final year of the program, students are really working towards meeting their graduation requirements. And one component of those requirements, the clinical requirements, is that you have a certain number of what we call continuity of care contacts. And what that means is that you've seen the same client throughout their prenatal care, you've attended their birth, and you've done postpartum visits with that client. So you've had continuity of their care throughout the whole experience. It doesn't have to be every single postpartum visit and every single prenatal visit, but it does require that you've had a certain number throughout the whole thing, including the birth. And those continuities often require 5 or 6 months of attending prenatal visits throughout a client's pregnancy. And just because that's the speed of pregnancy. And so when you need to attend at least 5 different visits across 2 different trimesters of pregnancy, and then the birth, and then a couple of postpartum visits after that, it does stretch out over a number of months. So in that final year of practicum, it's not really feasible to just have short rotations because you don't have that opportunity for that continuity of care. So it'll make more sense when you get into the program, but I hope that helps to explain that piece a little bit.
Yeah, thank you for explaining that in detail. I'm curious if there are a lot of locations that are close to the university that offer practicums as well, just for, you know, the cost of school is quite high, and then the cost of doing practicums, you know, in different locations and flying back to be able to be in class once a month. How many locations are actually within commuting distance by car to the university?
Yeah, the majority of our practicum sites are in, I would say, the Seattle-Tacoma metro area. But we do have sites all the way up in Bellingham, Washington, which is close to the Canadian border, and all the way down to Vancouver, Washington, which is close to the Oregon border. We have sites in Oregon, and then the further away you get, you know, into Idaho or California, Arizona, that's then looking like an airplane flight to come to campus. But even some of the sites in Washington are still kind of a long drive. Like you wouldn't be living on campus and commuting, you know, 3 hours down to Vancouver, Washington for a site. So that said, the majority of our preceptors are in the metro area around Seattle. But some aren't. So there, even if students live in Seattle, there is sometimes a need to relocate for one or both of their sites if it just doesn't match up with what the student's looking for.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Jess, I see several more questions for you. I'm going to take these one at a time. Does gaining a diploma allow for direct entry for work in Canada? We have had a number of Canadian students come through our program. And getting back into Canada after being trained outside of the country, no matter where you are outside of the country, is challenging, and it changes often. Not every Canadian province allows people to come in to Canada who are trained outside of the country. There are 4 midwifery schools in Canada, and they are hard to get into. They're small, and the demand for midwifery services in Canada is exploding. So I don't know why they make it so hard to get back into the country, but it is a challenge. So generally, what that typically looks like when that option is available is that after you have your training and your experience and you've graduated from the program, then you would apply for what they call a bridge program. And typically what that means is if you get accepted, you start maybe another year of training on like the Canadian healthcare system and how you get paid in their system. And midwives in Canada, most provinces offer to attend births in all settings. So they can do home birth center and hospital births. If all of your training has only occurred in home and birth centers, you're going to need some training on the hospital birth side of things. So usually there's some period of time of supervised practice where you would then be continuing your training under a Canadian midwife. And then after that year of bridging, that's when you get to sort of put on your midwife hat and become registered in Canada. So it's not a direct path to working in Canada, but there typically is this bridging program that'll take another year or so.
Thank you. Thank you for answering very specific questions as well. I'm a U.S. citizen who's working and living in Canada. I'm a permanent resident, and I got into UBC's midwifery program last year, but postponed. And so I'm just wondering if there's, you know, if I'm not deciding to live in one country or the other, would I have to do a bridge program if I studied in Canada to go back into the US as well?
One of the things that I've learned about British Columbia is that unless you are in a Canadian program, the only thing you can do as a student midwife is observe. And we had a student several years ago from BC who, you know, she had to move down here to do her training because since she was in a U.S. school, she was considered by the College of Midwives of BC to not qualify for practicum training in Canada. So all she could do was sit on our hands and observe births. And they're very serious about that. So it's not enough to just observe when you're training to be a midwife. Like you have to get in there and demonstrate skills and be able to show that you're able to be an entry-level midwife by the time you graduate. So the restrictions that British Columbia has put in place for, again, for training midwives in other countries makes it really hard to stay in Canada and then commute down to Seattle for the onsites. All you could do is observe there.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that knowledge.
Yeah, it's not great. Again, I don't know why they make it so hard, because people are really clamoring for midwifery care, and there just aren't enough midwives right now to meet the demand. Your next question was, what is the yearly cost? The tuition right now for the midwifery program, it varies a little bit by year because there's different credits in each year of the program, just a little bit different, but it's roughly about $35,000 a year. And I would love to talk a little bit more about our scholarship program as well, but I'm going to go to your last question. Is a master's of science from Colorado State satisfy the general education requirement, or are the specific courses listed for entry of someone without a bachelor's still necessary? I feel like I'm going to look to Carrie on that. Carrie generally evaluates.
Yeah. So what I would say is a master's in science has a really good chance of crossing off some of our things that we have on our list for prerequisites. And since you have a master's, then you don't have to worry about the general education requirements. That's general education requirements would be for someone that has not gotten their bachelor's or AA. It's easier to sometimes get your AA instead of doing the general education requirements, but definitely feel free to reach out to me and we can go over your specific situation. And I encourage everyone to send me their transcripts from all schools that you've attended so that I can review that for your particular situation.
Thank you, Carrie. Mm-hmm. Molly, you have a great question. What is the cohort size typically? We have a cap at 20 students per cohort. And that generally is due to the number of preceptors that we have. If we had more preceptors, we would be able to admit more students. But again, every midwifery education program is pretty limited by the number of preceptors that we have. So 20 is our maximum per cohort.
And how many people typically would you say apply per cohort? Like how many people? Yeah, I guess I'm wondering the acceptance rate.
Yeah. I might ask for help from Carrie on how many people apply, because I usually only typically see the ones who interview.
And I'm actually new too, so I don't know exactly how many people apply, but I have been told by my associates that we have a very high acceptance rate. So there's really good chances for you, if you're meeting the requirements, the GPA, and you're interviewing well, to be able to come here to Bastyr. So, and I will encourage you to talk to me about that as well, and how to prepare for interview.
Okay, thank you so much. And do you mind putting your email in the chat, Carrie? Because I would love to send the transcripts and ask you about prereqs.
Oh, definitely. Yes, I'll do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Carrie and our admissions team do an amazing job of preparing people to apply to the program. And once people have gotten to that stage of being ready to apply, they know what prereqs they still need. They have a plan for them. By the time they apply, they're pretty well prepared. And then by the time they come to me for an interview, they know what they want. They know what they're getting into. And we do have a pretty high acceptance rate once people get to that interview stage. So I credit our admissions team for doing a stellar job of helping people to prepare their applications. Elizabeth, I see your virtual hand is up.
Hey there. I have a number of questions, so I'm trying to figure out where it is that I should start. I am in my 30s. I am returning to school. I dropped out from Western in 2009. And I am trying to figure out essentially how it is that I can begin this journey. I have, I just took the doula course with the Simpkins Center in October 2023, and I really, really enjoyed it. Kim, the instructor, was fabulous. And so yeah, I am great. Currently working, she's wonderful. I am currently working in the restaurant industry. Obviously, this is a very difficult industry to work in when you are trying to go back to school, especially given the nature of doula work and midwifery work.
Yeah.
I am wondering a few things. As quickly as possible, get out of the restaurant industry because I've been in it for too damn long. And I am thinking about moving into doula care. So I guess I'm wondering what, if any, accommodations are available for students who are working in the field of birth work and do have to, you know, kind of drop everything and attend birth. I'm wondering, as somebody who doesn't have a bachelor's degree or an associate's, I do have a number of college credits. I did also take some prereqs, thinking that I might try to do like a accelerated BSN program. So, you know, we could probably cobble those together, but I guess I'm wondering if I pursue a CPM, but then because I'm particularly interested in the social justice work that Bastier offers as part of its midwifery program. If I did want to pursue a CNM, I'm wondering if like I do still need to complete a bachelor's program. Yeah, and I think I have about 500 more questions, but I think that those are the important ones.
Yeah. Yeah. I will say in taking that last question about, you know, if you wanted to move into a CNM program, that path requires that you become a nurse first. So if, let's say if there was a scenario where you did the prerequisites for our program, you started the program, and you decided at some point that nurse midwifery would work better for you, for your lifestyle or whatever that might be, you would need to get a bachelor's degree in nursing before you apply to the midwifery program. Like that's how that pathway works. You have to become a nurse before you become a midwife. So, I mean, we've had graduates of our program after a few years of practice decide that they want to be a nurse midwife for like expanded scope or working in a state where they can't get a license as CPM. And they literally have to start from the beginning. They have a master's degree in midwifery, but they have to go back and get a bachelor's degree in nursing before they can begin the midwifery part of the nurse midwife path. So I wish there was a better bridge, but because they require that nursing education before, like that's it's pretty inflexible in that regard.
Understood. And then what, if any, accommodations are there, like if I was to, you know, say move into doula work and, you know, kind of turn that into my form of income as I was pursuing a midwifery degree with Bastier?
Yeah. I mean, I think that we've had a number of students in the past continue their doula work while they are in the first two quarters of the program. But then in the third quarter, when practicum gets layered on top of the coursework, and they're expected to be in the office with their preceptors, you know, 1 or 2 days a week, and to attend births. And that means being on call. And so, you know, the on-call lifestyle of the doula added to the on-call lifestyle of the midwife, it just increases the risk for conflicts of whose birth do I go to? And also, you know, sometimes they conflict with on-site weeks. So when our students are in the classroom, they cannot be on call because it's the only time that month that they're getting that face-to-face time with their instructors. So we don't allow our students to be on call for their preceptors or for doula births while they're at on-site. So it gets tricky, you know, the more unpredictable your life is, the trickier it gets. And so, you know, I wouldn't, you know, say that like doing one doula birth a month, you know, if everything lined up well, and babies took their turns, you know, that might work for a while, but you would definitely need to have a backup plan if someone went into labor while you were at on-site or were at a birth with your midwife preceptor.
Understood. Thank you.
Layla, I see you have your hand up.
Hi. So mine's kind of like the opposite. I'm still a junior in high school. So
nice.
I haven't gone to college yet, obviously. But next year I'm planning on doing Snow Isle and getting my CNA. And that starts me on like the nursing track, I guess. Mm-hmm. And if I go to a community college and master in nursing, I don't know if that'll put me on the path for a nurse midwife or if I like don't go to a 4-year university and get like my actual nursing degree mm-hmm. and then come there. Mm-hmm. Like, does that have any effect or?
First, I just want to just take my hat off to you, Layla, for knowing and taking the path of where you want to go with midwifery. It's not common. You know, a lot of people don't even know what a midwife is. And for you to be still in high school and pursuing this path, I think that's amazing. So good for you. We actually have a number of students in our current first year cohort with CNA backgrounds. It's very interesting that so many of them have CNAs. I don't know what aligned in the universe to bring them all together in our program this year, but it is a great background. It just provides a lot of skills that end up coming in handy in lots of different healthcare arenas. I haven't really looked at the curriculum for being a CNA, or even like an associate's degree in nursing, but I imagine that there's quite a bit of overlap with our prerequisites. I think Carrie has put some information in the chat about our program overview, and that lists all of the prerequisites there. So that might be a good thing to look at and compare. Or you can just call Carrie and, you know, she can help you walk through it.
Our college and career center person actually already talked to her for me. And so I have it all printed out already.
Spectacular. Great counselor.
Yeah, she's.
Yeah, but you're never really locked into one path or the other in terms of becoming a CPM or a nurse midwife. I mean, there's a lot of overlap. It's just the, you know, the requirement to become a nurse before you become a midwife in the nurse midwife pathway that's pretty like you have to do it in that order. But if you were to start with some nursing courses, become a CNA, that fits pretty well. And again, we've got several students with that background right now.
And then also Do you have any suggestions on like places to go to complete the like doula training and childbirth education prerequisites that are needed? Because it says they're not college, like not a college course. So
that's right. Yep. So we have our own Simkin Center, which offers multiple trainings in allied birth professions, we call it. So they do have doula trainings, childbirth educator trainings, and many more, lactation consulting, and just tons of courses. So those are offered on a pretty regular basis. So that's one approach, and maybe Carrie can, she's already put that in the chat, the Simkin Center. That was like three messages ago. So that's a great place to get those trainings done. Another is an organization called Birthing Advocacy. And they have, they do both doula training and childbirth educator training, and they package them together for midwifery students who are preparing to enter midwifery school. And maybe Carrie's pulling that URL out right now. Okay. But they have a great training that is very much rooted in social justice and reproductive justice. So we love their trainings, and again, they do offer kind of a package deal for midwifery students that is a little bit less expensive than doing them separately. Yes, BA doula trainings. Yeah, great question. I am going to jump back to Jess's question in the chat where she's said, do you know if Bastier's master's completion allows for direct entry for work in New York State? New York is a very tricky state. Currently, their requirements are that you have to have graduated from an approved master's degree program or a graduate program in midwifery. And the only programs, so currently only nurse midwives and certified midwives, which is another certification that starts to muddy the waters, but they go to nurse midwife programs and graduate from their programs that are accredited by their agencies, and they are currently the only ones who have like an easy path to licensure in New York State. There are lots of people out there who are just waiting for a Bastier graduate to challenge New York State's licensing rules, because you would come in with a master's degree. And so we're looking forward to the day when one of our graduates is going to be like, yeah, I'm the one. I'm going in with my Bastier degree, and I'm going to challenge these licensing rules and be the first CPM in New York State that's licensed. I will also say that there are lots of CPMs in New York that are actively working on legislation to create a path for CPMs to get licensed in that state. So what will happen first, I don't know, but right now in this minute, New York State has made it challenging. So maybe you'll be the first, Jess. Let's see, Molly asked, are only particular doula certifications accepted for that prerequisite for the course? I trained through DTI and I'm a full spectrum doula, but I'm not sure if I need to take another one. I am not familiar with DTI. I'm going to guess it stands for Doula Training International, but I'm not sure.
Yes, it does. Sorry, okay. I put that in there. Yeah, it was just where I trained back in Austin when I lived there, and that was the local, like the closest one to me. I trained through DONA as well, but I didn't like certify through them. I just wasn't sure if I needed to do, a different one since I didn't certify through DONA.
And this would be a good question for me, Molly, why don't you meet up with me and you, and you can send over what you have done, and I can see if we can have that approved.
Okay. So, thank you.
Okay, great.
And also, I'm just going to add to that, Molly, if you did the DONA training, that meets our requirements. We don't require that people get certified as doulas.
Okay. That's great. Okay.
Yeah. Thank so you. As long as you've gone through the training, that mm-hmm. is what we need.
Okay. Wonderful.
Yeah. Great. Any last questions as we have 5 minutes left?
Did you want to talk about scholarships?
Yes. Thank you, Carrie.
You're welcome.
Yes. So for those who are left, here's the bonus. Once upon a time, people attending medical schools and nursing schools and dentistry schools received lots and lots of funding from the federal government to help students go through those programs and become doctors and nurses and dentists. But it was only in 2020 when midwifery education programs were allowed to apply for those millions of dollars of scholarship funds. And so we applied for it in 2020 and we received it. We got a grant, a 5-year grant for $3.25 million for scholarships for our students. It is 100% for scholarships. And the size of those scholarships is required to be at least half the cost of tuition, to a maximum of $40,000. And students can apply for it every year. You become eligible through one of two paths, either a path that they call educational disadvantage, which means maybe you come from a high school with a low graduation rate, or there's a lot of kids on free lunch, or you're the first person in your family to go to college, a first generation college student. The other path is what they call economic disadvantage. And that would mean that your income is in your household is below the low income threshold that the government sets every year. And they change it a little bit every year, but if your household income is below that threshold for that year, then you would qualify. So in the last 4 years, we're just now going into year four of this. We have given 75 scholarships of $40,000 each. And the exciting part of that is our federal government has actually thrown more money into the pot for midwives. So in that $3.25 million, it sort of breaks down over 5 years to be about $650,000 per year, which is mind-blowing. Like, midwives have never seen that much funding before. Last year, they bumped that up. Congress appropriated another $1 million for midwifery education programs. There's only four of us in the country who received this grant. The other three are nurse midwife programs. So we're the only one of a CPM program that received this. So they bumped up the funding. We got to give away $900,000 last year in scholarships for our students. And this year they gave us a cool million. So it just is like mind-blowing, and it has been an absolute game changer for our students. As we said, our tuition is about $35,000 a year. So a $40,000 scholarship takes care of all of that and then some. So it can be used for transportation, housing costs, books, you know, whatever. And it has just been a game changer to be able to reduce and eliminate that financial barrier for our students. So we're thrilled to be able to offer this. We've got one more year on this grant. And then I've been told as of last week that midwives will be included in the next round of funding as well in 2025. So super exciting, game-changing, incredible opportunity, and our students have really benefited from it. Layla, your hand is up.
So I won't be going there until probably 2027. I have at least another 3 years of school. But do you think those would be like available still? Do you think that there's a possibility of those still being available?
You know, I've been holding my breath to be like, I really hope that, you know, people in Congress continue to fund midwives as, you know, a needed profession in this country. And yeah, like I said, last week I was talking with somebody from this federal agency and they said, oh yes, midwives will definitely be included in the next round of funding. So it's a 5-year cycle. So we will apply in 2025, early in the year, hopefully receive it again. I knock on wood, don't see why they wouldn't fund us again, but we do have to apply. And then it would be for the next 5 years that we would have funding for student scholarships. So if you were looking to be starting in 2027, assuming that we get this grant, that funding would be available and during that cycle.
Perfect. Thank you.
Right on. Okay. Well, we're 1 minute over, so I'm going to wrap it up for today. Thank you so much for coming and for your great questions. And we hope that you'll be applying soon. Make sure to talk with Carrie and, we'll see you soon. Thanks.